there's a way to measure chaos, just like when we talked about the Lorentz system and we mentioned the Lyapunov exponent. You could calculate a Lyapunov exponent for maps, and it's basically the same thing. You look at a small separation, delta naught, between two initial conditions, but then look at how they grow under the map, the separation between the two. If it seems to grow exponentially, so at the nth iterate, you look at the magnitude. The magnitude seems to go like the initial separation times e to the n lambda. Lambda is the Lyapunov exponent. And there are ways to compute this. So people have computed this for things like the logistic map, and where the Lyapunov exponent is positive, we have sensitive dependence on initial conditions. If you have lambda that's negative, it means that things are actually coming closer together. They're going to an attractor. But if we wanted to have some signature of chaos, then you could look for regions that have a positive Lyapunov exponent. So if we did calculate this for the logistic map, then what would we get? We've got the bifurcation diagram up above, and below we're sh showing the calculated Lyapunov exponent and then coloring it red where it's positive. So you'll notice that it goes to zero where these bifurcations happen for period doubling. So if you were to look at the, corresponding location, this is where the other period doubling is. So this would be what R2 is, R1. This would be R3. So you could estimate these numerically by looking at where does the Lyapunov exponent go to zero. And then these windows of chaos, right, correspond to windows of positive Lyapunov exponent. But of course, it dips down. The largest dipping down to something that's not chaotic is in this period three window. So that's a way to get it. Is it really chaotic? Here's some quantitative way to say that it is. This is a little video that just sort of overlays them. So you could see that they happen at the same place. Now, I wanted to say something about other maps. We've said a lot about the logistic map, but then you might be wondering how generic is all of this? So we want to talk about universality and experiments. So how generic is this, say, period doubling cascade? Can you see this kind of stuff in experiments? Can you see it in the Lorentz system or other ODEs? What's the main feature of the logistic map? If we're just talking about a map of the unit interval to itself, maybe we want to focus on, if we were to put it informally, they have one hump. So one humped maps monotonically increases to some maximum and then goes down. Does it matter that we have something quadratic, or is this all that matters? The technical term for one humped is unimodal, and there's other unimodal maps. One of the unimodal maps that's kind of known is the sine map. So you could design a map that's just r times sine pi x n. So that's another map. It'll actually show the same sort of bifurcation diagram. So you can calculate bifurcation diagram. So this is called the sine map for obvious reasons. It'll look something like what I've actually shown here, right? Between 0 and 1, 0 and 1. And it's got a parameter, right? We need the parameter if we're going to show the map. So here's the bifurcation diagram for the logistic map again. Just keep that in mind. Now here's the bifurcation diagram for the sine map. Notice the parameter along the bottom is different, but they look a lot alike. You see the same sort of thing. There's period doubling, there's windows of chaos and windows of periodicity. There seems to be this large window of what looks like a period three thing. If you were to zoom on each of these little branches, they look like small copies of the entire thing. So there's something universal that was first seen in the logistic map, but is pretty generic for these unimodal maps. Looks the same. So what's going on? We'll probably talk about the kind of heavy-duty renormalization theory of why these look the same and show certain universal traits. But let me mention the Rossler system and then some experiments. So the same sort of bifurcation diagrams are seen in systems of differential equations and experiments. So for example, there's the Rossler system, nothing to do with me. It's got two dots over the O. This is a set of three differential equations, and it's the simplest nonlinear one that exhibits a strange attractor. It's x dot equals negative y minus z. It has to be 3D. We can't get chaos and strange attractors in anything less than 3D. Y dot equals x plus ay. Notice so far everything's linear. There's only one nonlinear term, and it's in this z dot equation. So we have a constant b plus z times x minus c. So the only nonlinear term is there. It's got a single nonlinear term, but it shows a strange attractor. And it shows a route to chaos through period doubling. So if you were to look at what the system does, the system shows period doubling as a parameter is varied. For example, C, this one right here, C is varied. So if we were to just look at, say, X and Y for C equals 2.5, we'll see a limit cycle. And then we'll see that thing split into two by C equals 3.5 and so on. We just get more and more period doubling until we have an attractor. And the attractor, it looks like one of the sides of the Lorentz attractor. It's got some weird shape in 3D. I'm just sort of showing an X. Look like I scribbled, but it's really an XY projection of the Rossler attractor. And this would be like at C equals 5. You've definitely got the attractor. So we've got a period doubling bifurcation of limit cycles that leads to this. If you were to then do something like the Lorentz map, where you look at the peak of X, just like Lorentz looked at different peaks of Z, then you could make a map. So here's X max, the nth X max, and then you plot the n plus 1th X max, and you'll get points that seem to fall on a curve, much like the Lorentz map. And you could look at intersections with the 45 degree line and so on. It looks unimodal. And because of that, and it's almost a closed curve, like we could just link it together, say, well, it's, you know, kind of a closed curve. As you vary a parameter, you could get a bifurcation diagram. And look at this, it looks very similar to other things we've seen before. How in any way is this system related to the logistic map, except it could be reduced to what looks like a unimodal map when viewed the right way? So here's that bifurcation. Still, we get period doubling, we get chaos, we get the period three windows. So all of this stuff seems to be quite generic to systems. The Rossler equations didn't have anything to do with mechanics or anything, just some ODEs. So what's going on here? Looks like the logistic map. Something universal is going on. What I wanted to show is some experiments. There's a model of convection rolls. It's not the same as the Lorentz attractor. Actually, this isn't a model, sorry. This was an experiment done in the early 80s. A box containing liquid mercury is heated from below. And the control parameter, it's the same as the Lorentz system, R, the Rayleigh number. It's a measure of the externally imposed temperature gradient from the bottom to the top. And for R less than a critical value, heat is conducted upward while the fluid remains motionless. But if you're above that critical value, then the motionless state becomes unstable and you get convection occurring in typically cylindrical rolls. So in this very carefully done experiment, they looked at the temperature at some random point in the fluid and just measured the temperature. So this is showing the measurement of the temperature over time at different values of R over R critical. And maybe you could see what's happening here. The first thing looks like it's just look at the peaks. Peaks are all about the same height. So I'd say the top row at 3.47 is period one. And then at 3.52, we've got period two. And then 3.62 looks like we got period four. And then it goes to period eight. So we have a period doubling cascade even in this system. So that's a careful physical system. This has also been seen in experimental cardiac tissue, low dimensional chaos in cardiac tissue. And it's hard to do some of these experiments, especially if you're trying to pick up something like that bifurcation diagram, because you have to kind of pick the parameter value and get things to map. So what they're trying to show, I think it shows it better down here. They're saying, look at these dynamics of cardiac tissue. We've got this period one and then a period two. Here's the bifurcation diagram, kind of read it from right to left. So this basic cycle length would be kind of the bifurcation parameter, the control parameter. And it's like we're getting a bifurcation diagram going from right to left. You know, that's pretty good. And then they even reduce this to a map and say, oh, look, we have these interesting things going on. I think this must be a model because there's way too much detail here. This can't be from experiments down there, but the other stuff was experiments. So that's cardiac tissue. Very much related to that is neural firing patterns. I think they've got an experimental result here of something that looks like period. I mean, it's kind of a messy looking bifurcation diagram, but shows some similar things of there's one stable branch and then it goes to two, and then probably it's hard to see it. Maybe it's just, it looks like a bunch of chaos. In fact, this seems to show what looks like period doubling happening from both sides of whatever this parameter is, the ISI number. So this is, I think part of what they're seeing. You see what looks like period one up here along the top, and then you see this doubling, and then, okay, now it's looking kind of crazy and chaotic, and they could actually measure it and get at it. So this stuff is real. It's seen in real physical systems. And again, there's something universal about it. And for a while, I think mostly in the 80s and 90s, there was a lot of work just to sort of show that there was this universality. It seems to have tempered, and maybe people have, okay, I've seen enough. I get it. Chaos is everywhere and seems to follow some common rules. We want to say more about what are these universal aspects? So the universal aspects of period doubling, there was a mathematical physicist named Feigenbaum. I think he was at Los Alamos. He was noticing this sort of universal thing about maps, especially unimodal maps. And it kept getting rejected, but he finally got something published in 1978 in the Journal of Statistical Physics. And if you want to see what this guy looks like, there he is. You see what looks like branchings and messy chalkboard behind. I think here's him dropping papers on the campus of Cornell, caught in a chaotic moment there. But what he did is he studied period doubling in various unimodal maps, and he found quantitative laws independent of the precise form of the map. So if we were to write the map, let me just say it's a unimodal map. It's got a parameter in front times some function, where the function just has one peak. So he found quantitative laws independent of the precise form of F. And to do that, he used connections to statistical physics, in particular, an analogy to universal exponents that were observed in phase transition phenomena in magnets and superfluids and other things. Just to give an idea, if you were looking at the average magnetization in a material as a function of temperature, you would find that the magnetization was like zero at high temperatures. And below some critical value of the temperature, it does something. It kind of looks like a transcritical bifurcation, but the kind of average magnetization rose from zero to something non-zero. And you could model that as M was proportional to the difference between T and T critical raised to some exponent. And these exponents were found to be kind of universal. Another connection to statistical physics was this use of something called renormalization. So used, and we'll talk more about that next time. So used renormalization to explain period doubling, which seems odd. Take this stuff that's used for, you know, real physics and apply it to something that seems more mathematical, or this field of chaos that's limited to goofballs. So this led to predictions about the route to chaos that were confirmed by experiment, not just qualitatively, like I showed above, but there's some quantitative aspects. So experiments in fluids, chemical oscillators, like some that we've talked about, semiconductors. What it's kind of based on is if you were to look at that bifurcation diagram. So this is a schematic of a bifurcation diagram. We've got the parameter and then the points that are on the attractor. But then we've plotted here, this is XM. It's the maximum. You could look at the distance between, if this is R1 and this is R2 and this is R3, this distance and this distance, and give them names. I'll call this interval delta N. Yeah, let me not call this R1. Let me give it more general things like Rn, Rn plus 1, Rn plus 2. Let's call this interval delta n plus 1. We've already said that delta n over delta n plus 1 went to some number, delta 4.669, some constant as n goes to infinity. So this is the distance between the branches in the parameter space. But there was also something about the distance between these branches this way. So if I call this, go measure from XM, so the branch that intersects XM, go to the other branch, we call this DN. And then after the other branching, you look at where that intersects. Some branch always has to intersect this XM point. The maximum, in general, that's what it is. The location of the maximum of F. DN, this distance actually flips. So it's positive or negative. If you look at DN, over dn plus 1, this actually tends to something universal. It tends to, and that number is called alpha, and it's negative 2.5029 as n goes to infinity. So using this universal scaling in both the x and the parameter r is what's at the heart of the renormalization theory that we'll talk about next time. These numbers were then later experimentally verified. It's actually hard to do because you have to be able to do an experiment with precision over many orders of magnitude to measure these things. But these things have been measured in experiments. So there's some kind of universal constants in the universe. And they're non-dimensional. That's cool.